The Titanic saga is well worn, and it has been told a million times. If you've ever watched a documentary on the ship, you've probably heard metaphors about ice cube trays overflowing and heard all about watertight doors, compartments, rivets, and all that. But what exactly does it all mean? Why wasn't Titanic designed to withstand the iceberg? What exactly caused the ship to sink so quickly? How can ice damage steel? Well, today, let's take a close look at all this and more and find out just how the iceberg sank the Titanic. To answer this question, we have to look at the events in four steps. First, the ship's design. Second, the events of the night. Third, the damage. And fourth, the aftermath. Let's get started. First, some quick context. Titanic was designed and built by an incredibly experienced team of engineers, builders, and artisans. And even though it was heralded as the world's largest ship at the time, the Titanic was actually built in an almost identical manner to hundreds and hundreds of other ships. You see, Harland & Wolff, the shipbuilding firm that built Titanic in Belfast, had been building ships since 1861, and they were pretty damn good at it. In fact, they were up there as one of the best shipbuilding firms in the world. They were the builders of choice, not just for Titanic's owners, the White Star Line, but dozens of other shipping lines like P&O, Union Castle, Furness Bermuda, Royal Mail Line, and many more. But a long-standing agreement saw White Star Line commissioning virtually every one of their ships to be built by Harland & Wolff. One of the many stupid myths about the Titanic disaster is that Harland & Wolff was a cost-cutting organization and built their ships out of substandard materials, and it's just not true. They'd been doing this for a long, long time, they knew their stuff, and they were extremely proud of their product. So when the White Star Line began discussing plans for a trio of superliners early in about 1907 or 1908, Harland & Wolff was all ears. They knew they'd have to overhaul their entire shipyard to accommodate the massive engineering task, so they knocked down all their old slipways and built a monstrous gantry to support cranes and build the new ships, as well as a cavernous graving dock to fit the ship out once it was afloat. Oh look, there's me. Anyway, the reason I'm telling you all this is because I want to try to highlight something for you. Titanic and her two sisters, Olympic and Britannic, were not really that special. Yes, they were big. Really big for the time, but Harland & Wolff wasn't going to reinvent the wheel on this project. They took what they had built on a smaller scale for ships like White Star's Oceanic, Laurentic and Adriatic, and they scaled the designs way up. So if you can understand how Olympic and Titanic were built, then you really know how almost every Harland & Wolff ship was built in the lead up to the 1920s. So when White Star Line began talking about advanced safety features for the new ships, Harland & Wolff was happy to oblige them, because up until only relatively recently, by then, travel at sea was a bit of a gamble. Fairly regularly, ships were lost in storms and just never showed up. White Star Line cut its teeth on the run to Australia. That was a particularly dangerous route, and the worst 19th century loss of life in Australian waters happened after about 4 months at sea, when the sailing ship Cataraqui was just a day away from docking safely in Melbourne. So the travelling public was a bit apprehensive about travel at sea, and it certainly didn't help that in 1909 White Star Line lost a ship, the Republic, when it was rammed and sunk off Nantucket. White Star and Harland & Wolff would go above and beyond to make sure that Olympic and Titanic were as safe as possible. Safer, really, than any other ship afloat. And then they'd market the hell out of that fact. So what does this all have to do with the design? Well, let's take a look at how Titanic was built from the ground up. Titanic's hull basically formed a giant box girder. If you can picture it that way, then all the individual components will start to make sense. Box girders are immensely strong, and they are ideal for resisting torsion or twisting, which is very useful in ships because they are very long and prone to flexing and twisting while going over big waves at sea. Box girders require four walls to function. In Titanic's case, the bottom wall was the keel, the top wall was the strength deck at B deck, and the two side walls were the hull. Here's how it was built. First, the keel was laid. This is essentially the ship's backbone. It comprised a flat keel plate, which sat on top of the slipway's blocks, and then a girder, which ran most of the length of the ship. Then, along the length of the keel, were fitted these things called floors. They provided something for more longitudinal girders to be riveted to alongside the keel. And slowly, the width of the structure increased until you had an immensely strong steel skeleton. The bottom of this was plated. These steel plates basically formed a watertight skin for the ship. They were made of steel and were surprisingly thin. On Titanic, the plates ranged from 0.64 of an inch, 1.6 centimeters, to about 1.25 inches at their thickest, which was 3 centimeters. The bottom of the Titanic, under the keel, was where the heaviest plates were used. Those were the big 1.25 inch plates I just mentioned. Now, on earlier ships, this is kind of where the yard would move on to the next step, but by Titanic's day, things had developed a bit and the ship was given a double bottom. This basically involved riveting a second watertight skin of plates on top of the keel structure. The deck that was created from this was called the tank top, and for good reason, because the space in between the plates on the bottom of the keel and the plates on top at the tank top was subdivided into tanks for ballast and salt water. The reasoning for this was simple. Ships, for as long as they had existed, had been bumping into things, so there was a lot of knowledge around the kind of damage a ship was likely to encounter. Grounding damage was some of the most common and the worst. In fact, the Costa Concordia kind of fell victim to this as late as 2012. If Titanic encountered shallow rocks or something that could pierce the bottom plating and open the ship's hull up to the ocean, it would sink quickly. The second layer of plating on top of the tank top would prevent this from happening. Crucially though, this second row of plating ended there. It did not continue up the sides of Titanic's hull, but we'll get into that in a minute. Next to the floors were riveted giant frames, which began to form the hull. And these were the sidewalls of the box girder. These were forged steel beasts, multiple stories tall, bent into the correct shape to give Titanic's hull its streamlined hydrodynamic form, and they ran the length of Titanic's hull, spaced out every 24 to 33 inches depending on their location. To these frames were riveted the majority of the Titanic's hull plates, basically the external skin of the ship. From here up, the plates, which weren't part of the double bottom, were a little bit thinner. This was to save a bit of weight and to give the ship greater flexibility while rocking and rolling through a storm. Each plate had rows of rivets hand-driven into each edge, holding them all together. The rivets were wrought iron, pushed red-hot into place, and then hammered home until they fastened two plates together. 3 million rivets were used to construct Titanic's hull, and every single plate edge was dotted with dozens of them. If you were standing in the Titanic's boiler or engine room, way down at the bottom of the ship, you'd be standing on top of the tank top. Looking to the side, you'd see the big frames, just where they curve downwards to join the keel and its floors, and then you'd see the plates. There is nothing between those plates and the ocean on the other side. There's not a second layer or inner skin or anything like that. Finally, to give the box girder its roof, the reinforced strength deck, which on Titanic sat as high as B deck, was riveted into place and all the subsequent decks below it. Remember when I said Titanic's hull was a box girder? Well, here is an actual box girder design, a cross-section of the tubular Britannia Bridge. Looks familiar, right? Okay, so Harland and Wolff now have the hulk of a ship. At the moment, it's safe from damage to the bottom in, say, a grounding. But what if the ship's hit from the side? An impact from a collision from the side would mean that water could flood the hull and sink the ship in minutes. No, something had to be done to prevent this, but it kind of seems incredible that the idea of watertight compartments was kind of revolutionary. For hundreds of years, ships had just sailed around without them. But Titanic took the idea to the next level. Titanic's hull was divided into 16 watertight compartments, basically massive self-contained rooms, by 15 bulkheads, which were essentially heavy-duty steel walls that ran up the hull as high as practicable. These were made of steel plating and, of course, ran through some passenger and crew areas in the lower decks. This meant that to get through them there had to be some kind of doorway fitted that could be sealed up in the case of an emergency. On Titanic, this came in the form of the watertight door, and the ship had a couple of different types. First is probably the most famous, seen here dramatically closing in the 1997 movie Titanic. These ran on rails and closed downwards. They were made of heavy cast iron, and in the boiler and engine rooms had to be wide enough for men to be able to pass through with coal-carrying wheelbarrows. The doors were held open by a clutch, and this could be released automatically by switches in the bridge, or individually by simply lifting a hand lever connected to the clutch. Each door could also be closed manually by hand-cranking it shut from the deck above. And one final safeguard was installed. In the event of flooding, a float would raise the lever and disengage the clutch, lowering the door. The doors were designed to lower slowly at first so men could get out of the way, but for the last 18 or 24 inches, the door would drop suddenly like a guillotine to create a watertight seal. This guy in the movie would have been in big trouble. The second kind of watertight door closed horizontally, or laterally, and these were the ones found in most of the passenger and crew areas on Titanic's lower decks. These had to be manually hand-cranked shut, either on site or from the deck above. The watertight bulkheads had as few openings as possible, and when the doors were shut, created a compartment with four watertight surfaces. The tank top, the hull sides, and the two watertight bulkheads at either end. However, there was no watertight top surface. The decks above weren't made watertight because the bulkheads rose fairly high up in Titanic's hull above the normal waterline up here on E deck. With this system in place, Titanic could survive a number of theoretical disasters. If hit by another ship from the side, two or three of the Titanic's compartments would flood, but the ship could float, because the water could only flood about as high as the top of the watertight bulkheads. If the ship received damage to the first three or even four of her watertight compartments, say in some kind of sideswipe collision or impact, then the water also could not flood any higher than E-deck, because the ship would find equilibrium, the flooding would stop, and the ship would survive, although its bow would be pretty low down in the water. Basically, Titanic was designed to withstand any and all the kind of damage that ships had experienced up until that point. Bow-on collisions, groundings, impacts from the side, Titanic could survive them all. She was almost... what's a good word here? Unsinkable? Unsinkable. Yeah, that's a good one. Let's use that. Part 2. The events. Just before midnight, on April 14th, 1912, Titanic's lookouts and bridge spotted an iceberg ahead at around about the same time. The ship only had seconds to react, but it was already too late. Instead of striking the iceberg head-on directly, Titanic's rudder had moved the nose of the ship away from the iceberg by a few degrees, so that the berg scraped past along the starboard side. Rushing to the bridge from his adjoining stateroom, Titanic's captain, Edward Smith, now had to diagnose his ship and gauge exactly what the situation was. He ordered the watertight doors closed, but First Officer William Murdoch reported he had already thrown the switches, so the vertical closing doors down in the boiler and engine rooms were shut. Then he ordered the ship's fourth officer, Joseph Boxhall, to go below and check for damage, and eventually the ship's carpenter too. Already, Titanic was exhibiting some strange symptoms. One of the ship's lamp trimmers walked up on deck at the very bow of the ship because he could hear a hissing noise. Up at the forepeak of the ship, the very front, was a vent for one of the ship's tanks, the peak tank. This was the forwardmost water tank on the ship, and in order to be able to trim the level of the ship and keep it on an even keel, it could be filled or emptied with seawater. The air had to be displaced when it was being filled, so the vent allowed air to escape out. But now, it was loudly hissing, indicating that the forepeak tank was taking on water at an alarming rate. And just after this area, in cargo hold number one, boatswain's mate Albert Haynes was investigating for damage, and he could hear water rushing in from somewhere. The number one cargo hatch ran all the way down into the belly of the ship, and at certain levels was covered with tarpaulins or grates. He found that the tarpaulin was being pushed up by air as it escaped upwards, displaced by the water. This was all reported to the bridge, and to Smith, this meant that the forepeak tank and one watertight compartment were already open to the ocean and flooding. Then there came more bad news. Boiler room 6 was flooding rapidly. So rapidly that the crew had to escape up emergency ladders to get out of the way of the water. That made at least two major compartments flooding, but then there came more news from the post office. This was located up on G deck and had a mail sorting room just one deck below on the orlop deck. 10 minutes after the collision, water began to flood the mail sorting room on the orlop deck, and the clerks began to shift mail as fast as they could to save it. This mail room was located in the watertight compartment forward of boiler room number 6. That now made three compartments open to the ocean. Finally, Smith himself went below to check the damage. Cargo holds 1, 2, and 3 were flooding. Boiler room 5 had a small hole, and it was flooding too, just slower. About 20 minutes after the collision, the squash racket court was reported to be flooding as well. For Titanic's commander and officers, it painted a disturbing picture. The forepeak tank taking on water, cargo holds 1 and 2 flooding rapidly, cargo hold 3 flooded and water now lapping in the squash court, boiler room 6 flooded, and boiler room 5 taking on water. This spelt the end for Titanic. The ship was designed to stay afloat with four of those compartments flooded, but now, with the bow of the ship being pulled down by the weight of water in five compartments, it was past the tipping point, and water would surge up over the bulkheads because, of course, the top of the compartments were not made watertight. And this it did. By 12:45 a.m, around an hour after the collision, steward Joseph Wheat found water pouring down the E-deck steps which led down to the Turkish bath one deck below. This meant that water was coming up over the watertight bulkheads separating the damaged boiler room 5 from boiler room 4 directly below and flooding aft into the ship. Number 3. The damage. So what happened to cause this kind of widespread flooding? I mentioned earlier that Titanic didn't hit the iceberg head-on, and that it managed to turn a couple of points and get its nose out of the way of the iceberg ahead. This meant that Titanic's side brushed up against the iceberg, and suddenly the ship's entire 40 or 50,000 ton mass was grinding up along the ice. That ice, by the way, is extremely compact glacial ice, very dense stuff. By contrast, Titanic was, well, a bit squishy. You see, steel bends quite a bit under pressure, If you look at these photos of Titanic's sister ship Olympic after a 1911 collision, you can see that the steel plating's bent upwards like wet cardboard, and the rivets have all popped out of place. The rivets on Titanic were immensely strong, but when the ship came into contact with the iceberg, a huge amount of pressure was put on them and they likely burst in some sections along the hull's plates to open up ever so slightly and allow water in. It wasn't a dramatic tear hundreds of feet long. If that was the case, Titanic would have sunk in minutes and not over 2 hours. No, it was a series of small cuts in the hull plating, and thanks to sonar imagery and the damage reports from the night, we have a pretty good idea of where they were. The first cut probably appeared here, in the region of the forepeak tank. This caused the hissing noise that could be heard as it flooded with water. Next, a 5 and a 6 foot gash were both put into cargo hold number 1. Then, the seams of plates in cargo hold 2 opened up for about 16 feet. Just after this, between cargo holds 2 and 3, a 33 foot gash opened up Titanic's fourth watertight compartment. And finally, just after this, a big 45 foot incision opened up boiler room 6, and just a little bit of boiler room 5. The plates could only have been separated by about 0.5 inch to 6 inches, but those openings were enough to doom the Titanic. 4. The aftermath. The immediate shock and outrage caused by the disaster initiated wide sweeping changes to the way ships were designed and built for the next few decades. The most obvious solution was to install a second inner skin to the hull, like the double bottom but running up the height of the boiler and engine rooms. This modification was made to Olympic and was built into Britannic, the third and final sister ship. Then the watertight bulkheads were raised higher. On Olympic, these went as high as B deck, the strength deck, but it also meant that now in public spaces, there had to be installed the big horizontal closing watertight doors. After the Titanic disaster, the general consensus somehow became that a 300 foot long gash in the ship's hull had been ripped open by the iceberg, but this just wasn't possible because such extreme damage would have sent Titanic to the bottom way faster. It was Edward Wilding, who was one of the chief designers on the Titanic project, who first postulated that the ship's damage had only been intermittent. He said that, "I cannot believe that the wound was absolutely continuous the whole way. I believe that it was in a series of steps, and that it was the end of one of these series of wounds which flooded the different spaces," referring to boiler rooms number 6 and 5. In 1986, Wilding may have been proved correct. Dr. Robert Ballard observed from a submarine what little could be seen of the area that made contact with the iceberg and found plate damage. In fact, he saw a 45 foot long opening about 1 to 6 inches wide in the seams of the plates. This was the one that directly opened up boiler room 6 and part of boiler room 5. The incision that doomed the Titanic.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's your friend Mike Brady from Oceanliner Designs. Thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, like and subscribe to the channel. Every bit helps, and I put out a new video every week, so you'd hate to miss out. If you'd like to support my work, please subscribe to me on Patreon, or you can sign up for a YouTube membership for perks like early access, behind the scenes, and many more. You'll find the link in the description below. As always, stay safe, stay happy, and I'll see you again next time.